Hey everybody, and welcome to my TNA Lockdown 2014 pay-per-view review, in which we saw Magnus retain the TNA World Title, Team MVP take control of the company operations, and Madison Rayne retaining her Knockouts title, and Gunner getting a big victory over James Storm in the personal battle. On top of other things. So let's get right into the review. We kicked off the show with the six-man interpromotional tag team match in which the Great Muta, Sanada, and Yasu defeated Bad Influence and Chris Sabin. So the Wrestle 1 representatives beat the TNA representatives in what I thought was a decent way to kick off this show. I won't, you know, say that this match was like unbelievably good or, you know, blew me away. I think it was a good way to open up the show, and I think it was probably the best match to kick off the show as well. I like that they went interpromotional because, you know, again, you're expanding the horizons of your promotion beyond the United States, and with the Wrestle 1 partnership and everything. I think that this match would have been better off had it been promoted a little bit better on TNA television, but even with that said, that's just a production thing. Overall, I think this match itself was pretty solid. Seeing the Great Muta, he was clearly very over, as would be no shocker there. I think it's no surprise that the Wrestle 1 guys beat the heels for TNA, but a very nice way to kick off the night and get things going on the right foot, in my opinion, for Lockdown. This was about a 3, I'd say maybe a 3.5, 3.25, 3.5 out of 5 overall for me. So a good way to kick off the night. Then we go right into Samuel Shaw and Mr. Anderson, which was one of the better matches of the night as well, in my opinion. This was a steel cage match that was escape only, so I like that they made it that stipulation. The match itself was basically just a television match, really not a whole lot special to it. Mr. Anderson had the thing won, but Hemi was, you know, near the outside, and she got pulled in by Shaw. And the referee was knocked out, so Anderson gets back into the ring, fights Shaw off, helps Hemi get out of the ring, ends up getting low-blowed and choked out by Samuel Shaw, and by the time the referee's up, he sees Shaw leaving the cage, so Shaw actually wins the match. Very, very important victory for Samuel Shaw. This is really his first pay-per-view match here, and obviously he needed the pay-per-view victory over Mr. Anderson. It wouldn't have made sense otherwise, in my opinion. And but on top of that, I don't think the match was too terrible. I think the story that came with it at the end with him pulling in Hemi, that was kind of an interesting thing to me. I liked the little bit of story they told here. I think this was the kind of match where you can have that kind of a freaky finish because it actually makes some sense given the storyline. I think Samuel Shaw, the little promo they cut beforehand, was pretty good, especially Shaw's. By having him sit on top of the cage, I thought that was good as well. I think this overall was pretty solid. I'd probably throw about the same rating at it, like a 3.5 out of 5 for me. It might be generous on some people's opinions, but the later matches weren't so great. So I think Lockdown, after the first two matches, was doing okay. I think the first match was good, and I think this was a decent follow-up. I'll just give it a 3.25 out of 5, 3.25. So a little bit lower than the opener, but because the match quality wasn't fantastic, I think that the story that came with it and the interesting finish was something worth noting. We'll see where they go with it down the line. I think this feud could continue on. That would be okay with me into next month's pay-per-view. Either way, I think this was a good win for Shaw. It could have been better, but still decent. Then we get Ethan Carter III versus, was supposed to be versus Kurt Angle, but obviously Angle is out with a legitimate torn MCL. And we will see how this feud picks up down the line, and I hope it does. I really do, because I think that EC3 and Kurt Angle's match would have been nice and a good one for EC3 to maybe get a victory in. But he ends up facing Bobby Lashley here. Bobby Lashley returns. Obviously, this isn't the kind of return for me personally that makes me like mark out or anything. I mean, I think it's cool to see Lashley back in a professional wrestling ring, but I was never really the biggest fan of his at any point in time. So, you know, for me, it was okay. I mean, but either way, it wasn't really a match. It ended up just turning out to be Lashley beating the shit out of EC3. So I guess we'll see where they go with Lashley's return. Hopefully it turns out to be pretty solid. I don't know if he's back full-time or if it's just a part-time deal. So I guess we'll have to see where that whole thing goes with Lashley. I don't know if they're going to continue the feud with EC3 or not. That would work for me. I don't really care, and I think that this was not really a part of the pay-per-view I'm going to give a rating to, because it just didn't really go anywhere, and I think TNA didn't really have a whole lot to do otherwise with it, so too bad. Then we get Tigre Uno and Manic. Tigre Uno beats Manic off that that great splash that he did. That was a fantastic finish. Some really nice spots here. This was a spot fest kind of match. If you didn't expect this to be a spot fest match, that was a tongue twister, then I don't know why you would think that, because this is exactly the kind of match that was going to be, kind of an X Division worthy type of deal. I think Tigre Uno has a future here for TNA. I hope that they use him. Again, a luchador here, and I think his mask is kind of intriguing. And Manic, again, good character. I hate that they've kind of ruined it by, you know, we know who he is under the mask, and they like openly admit that it's CJ Perkins. I think that's kind of stupid. But regardless of that, this was a solid matchup for me. I like the spots in it. Again, you know, it would have been more enjoyable, and obviously the crowd would have been more invested in it if there was actually a story behind it. Despite the fact that, say, like, let's just look at Samuel Shaw and Mr. Anderson. Their matchup wasn't, you know, anything real special. I mean, I did think there was a couple of spots that were really nice. And again, the whole finishing sequence was good for me, at least. But even with that said, I still think that there was more stock in that match, because you said to yourself, at least there's a story to this. And, you know, there's a reason why Sam Shaw is facing Mr. Anderson. Tigre Uno and Manic is pretty much just, it's happening because Tigre Uno is debuting for the company. So, I mean, it's a little bit of a different situation here. And I think this was a decent matchup that could have just been on, you know, Impact or whatever. I would have rather seen Abyss versus Eric Young on this card at some point in time, because they, you know, were actually building up to that. And I think this matchup did its job. It was solid. And, you know, again, the finish got the crowd popping again. But I think, again, it was harder to get into the match because, you know, there really isn't a whole lot of a backstory to it. It's kind of just a debut match. But either way, it was still really good. I'd probably throw about the same kind of rating at it. Probably like a 3.25, 3.5 out of 5. Nothing really over the top here. I mean, it's exactly as I expected. It didn't blow my mind, but it was still a good match. Next was one of my favorites of the night, probably my favorite of the night. It was the Last Man Standing steel cage match between Gunnar and James Storm. Great start to it by having them brawl outside of the cage before it even started. Just, you know, really building up the story of how personal of a feud it was right from the get-go. I thought that was great. I thought the finishing sequence with the big suplex on the two chairs was fantastic. They did some really nice spots here in this. You know, a chair was wedged in the corner, and Gunnar's face went right through it pretty much. But the finishing spot where, you know, Gunnar suplexed him off the top rope through the two chairs was a great finish. And Mike Tenay's reaction was actually really good for that. This was a great match. I enjoyed it a lot. Some people said there was a lot left to be desired and that they wish there was more to it. I think it gave what it gave. It could have gone a little longer for me, but overall, I still thought it was a really nice match. I'd go ahead and throw a full, we'll throw 3.75 out of 5 or 2 of 4. I don't know if it was really a 4-star match. I think maybe 3.75 out of 5 is good. And it was a very enjoyable match for me. I liked it a lot. So good props to those two guys. That was probably my favorite match of the day. And I like that Gunnar went over. He needed the win over Storm. It makes a lot of sense. And like I said, they built up the whole personal rivalry thing going on with them pretty well. And then we got Madison Rayne and Gail Kim. Rayne ends up retaining the belt. The finish was solid. The match itself, they tried to be a little bit innovative in it, and it worked in spots. At others, it didn't. I'll give Gail Kim credit for taking a couple of nice bumps in this match. The finishing sequence was pretty cool with the spear off the top. I thought that was a good way to finish it. I'm actually a little bit surprised Gail Kim didn't win the belt, because I was figuring we were going to see Lady Tapa eventually turn on Gail Kim and actually feud with her over the belt. I don't know what we'll see. This was good, but again, you know, the Knockouts division has a lot of room to grow and improve. On top of that, Madison Rayne's not the best champion ever, but I thought that they put in some effort to this, so I guess I'll throw a 1.75 or 2 at it. I don't know. It was all right. It just, again, nothing special, but even with that said, I still think it was, you know, at least there was some effort put in. The finish was okay. A couple of nice bumps in it. Just not really a whole lot special to it, and something I had no interest in from the beginning. So I guess it outdid my expectation by a little bit. So yeah, like a 1.75 out of 5 for me. Next was Magnus and Samoa Joe for the world title, and this was an underwhelming match for me. I didn't really enjoy it as much as I had hoped to. I think these two guys have put on better matches before easily, and I think that they can put on better matches down the line. It's not really, you know, in the end of the world. I know that those guys are better than that with each other. They have very good chemistry, and this was still a decent match. I'm not saying, you know, taking that away. I think the in-ring work was pretty good. A bit of a slow pace, and I, you know, for some that's boring. And for me, it's not a big deal when you have a world title match at a slower pace. I think that's okay. It was good, but, you know, again, I've seen these two guys do much better with each other. It's the finish that really shits the bed for me. That's what killed this one. Abyss comes out through the fucking ring and ends up destroying Samoa Joe, and that leads to Magnus beating him by knockout because he put on the rear naked choke after Abyss had already hit the black hole slam, and obviously Joe was already knocked out, so that was that. Really stupid finish to this match. And like I said, if Magnus was going to retain, because I'm happy Magnus retained, not upset with the result at all. But the fact that he beat, you know, again, had to have such a dirty finish to this match. And again, you're throwing Abyss into this, and when it really doesn't even make a whole lot of sense, in my opinion. Especially when they had, you know, him feuding with Eric Young before. Why wouldn't you have just had that feud culminate, like it's supposed to, at Lockdown and have a pay-per-view match between those two guys? That just makes so much more sense to me. But whatever. Again, Magnus has to retain, you know, with such a dirty fashion. Man, you know, it would have been nice to see Magnus actually go over somewhat clean, even if he had to use dirty tactics himself. You know, he cut a promo early in the night how he's had to do so much stuff by himself. What an ironic promo, and I know that was the point of it, but what an ironic thing, because every single thing that he has to do is with help from everybody else. Every type of defense he has had is with a bunch of 8-10 other people, you know, coming in and helping. At least this was only one person, but the way that they did it is just stupid, in my opinion. You could have had Magnus use a dirty tactic to win, but why the hell did Abyss have to be involved in this? Just a dumb finish to this match overall, in my opinion. I didn't enjoy that. The match itself was okay, like I said, decent, but didn't do a whole lot for me. I'm just going to give it a 3 out of 5. 2.75 or 3 out of 5. I wasn't impressed with this match, and more importantly, the finish didn't impress me at all. And then we get the Lethal Lockdown match, in which it's basically for control of wrestling operations in the company. Team MVP versus Team Dixie, in which it's Team MVP's MVP, the Wolves, and Willow taking on Bobby Roode, the Bromans, and Austin Aries. It was a very very good in-ring match, I thought, but having Bully Ray be involved as a special referee made absolutely zero sense, and him turning face ultimately made even less sense. They had this whole thing going where Dixie said she had an insurance policy that was going to help her win. No, whatever, but that's not really the what made me upset. It was the fact, and it's not really, didn't really make me upset. It's just, it's stupid, in my opinion, why Bully Ray would be the baby face to come out of all of this. And it ended up feeling at the end like it was more about Bully Ray turning face than it was about MVP now having operation control of TNA. That's what the big story here is. But for whatever reason, it felt more like it was important for TNA to hype the fact that Bully Ray just helped out Team MVP. 3 weeks ago, he's saying how he wants to, you know, powerbomb children or whatever and light people on fire, and has all these cryptic, odd, dark messages. And 3 weeks later, he's a freaking babyface helping Team MVP when he had nothing to do with Team MVP or Team Dixie at any point in time. And since he had no real, you know, association with Team Dixie and he's been off on this weird tangent, why the fuck would he be a help to Team Dixie anyway? Why would Dixie look at him as an insurance policy? He hasn't been somebody who's been consistently helping them. EC3 would have made more sense. Take EC3 off the card altogether and put him as a special ref here. He can't even help them out. He gets taken out. A real ref comes in, counts the three, whatever. I just don't think the Bully Ray thing made a whole lot of sense. I just think it was kind of ridiculous. The match itself was pretty good, and I'm glad Team MVP went over. But again, the whole Bully Ray thing, can we ever just have a match where Dixie doesn't come out midway through and have some special referee or some stupid shit like that? I thought this was a good match. Again, having Willow be in this match was really cool. Instead of Jeff Hardy, Jeff Hardy was out of, you know, was you know, banned from the building. They bring in Willow. That made sense. I love that he started off on top of the cage and just splashed onto everybody. That was really cool. Overall, I thought that this was a good in-ring match. You know, again, had its sloppy moments, but I think almost every Lethal Lockdown will. But overall, for me, it was a very good in-ring match. I just think that the whole Bully Ray thing was really stupid and took away from it big time. It's still a match that I will probably throw about 3.5 to... I'd say about 3.25, 3.5. Again, decent. You know, a lot of stuff tonight was decent. That's really the best word I can say to describe a lot of this stuff. And some of the other stuff was worse than decent. Nothing was mind-blowing. So overall, this card ends up being just okay. It ends up just being an alright pay-per-view. And what I had high expectations for, and I think this was a big chance tonight at Lockdown, for TNA to really have a great night and a great outing. And I don't think it really lived up to that great outing. I think they did a decent job of building up to the pay-per-view. Actually pretty well. And I think that there was some really nice matches on this card, you know, going into it. But I think it just kind of fell a little bit flat. It was just an all right pay-per-view. It was like a 5.75 out of 10 for me. That would be probably the number I'd give it. Maybe a solid 6. I think more like 5.5, 5.75. Nothing blew me away. I will say none of the matches were terrible, but none of them were really that great. And I think that the finishes to the Magnus Joe and the Team MVP, Team Dixie match were so unimpactful and stupid on pay-per-view that it just didn't do it for me. That's what really helped to make this show average for me overall, because those finishes to the two biggest matches were not good. I mean, you can't always have dirty finishes at every fucking pay-per-view. People are paying money to see the culmination of feuds. I understand like a Sam Shaw Anderson thing. That made sense in that, given that the way that that storyline was built up. But Magnus and Joe, you could have had Magnus use dirty tactics to win. But did Abyss have to come up through the ring? Did they have to do something like that when they could have just had EY versus him in a one-on-one match? Which would have made more sense given the storyline they were building up. The Lethal Lockdown match worked fine. It served its purpose. But Bully Ray, what involvement does he really have in this? None. Him turning face ends up being the biggest thing that comes out of this. Not MVP gaining control. That's what's supposed to be the big deal here. The finish was flat. The match was decent, so yeah, I mean, I don't even know if 3.5 stars is worth it. It's more like a 3-star match. Maybe. The finish has a lot to do with how good a match really is, and these finishes were unmemorable. This is not a pay-per-view I'd ever watch again. I mean, none of the matches blew me away. The interpromotional match was fine. It was solid. The Sam Shaw-Anderson thing was solid. Tigre Uno and Manic was solid. Gunner and Storm was very nice. And the other two matches weren't bad as far as match quality, but the finishes just sucked. And none of these matches overall had a lasting effect on me, or something that I would watch 3, 4, 5 times again, or even twice. Just an alright pay-per-view. 5.5 to 5.75 for me out of 10 overall for this one for TNA. A bit of a disappointment. Really didn't live up to what I was hoping it would. I think Lockdown 2013 was better than this, and that's not a good sign considering the fact that 2013 was not a good year for TNA. But I thought that particular match was pay-per-view was actually quite good. It was better than this one. No X Division title match, no tag team title match. I mean, and I understand, you know, but I mean, you know, all of a sudden the X Division title is on this one of the Japanese guys in the interpromotional match. You say, huh? You know, I mean, the title's changing hands in Japan and stuff. I mean, how are people that watch this stuff supposed to stay in tune with all of that? You have to wonder. I mean, the X Division hasn't mattered to TNA in a long time, and it was proved tonight that at one of their biggest pay-per-views, the X Division title wasn't even defended. Neither were the tag belts. And the non-existent TV belt. And that's nowhere to be found. Could have been something good for TNA. The Knockouts belt, you know, the Knockouts division used to be something that was actually a great piece of TNA's content and was clearly better than WWE. And now it's no better. It's probably worse. There's nothing to it anymore. And the X Division used to be something that made TNA stick out. And that's gone. The X Division still exists, but it's not good anymore. Again, I think that TNA has thinned out a lot, and that's been a problem. But, you know, like I said, three divisions that used to be very, very good and made TNA the better product in a lot of ways over WWE are now gone. and non-existent. Now, I understand the tag champs were involved in the Lethal Lockdown. That's fine. But, I mean, you know, you can't name more than three tag teams in TNA right now. So, it's a problem that's going to continue on here for them down the line. I think this show lacked in a lot of ways. I mean, you had three of these matches, if you want to count EC3 and Lashley, that didn't really have any promotion at all. Because, I mean, EC3 and Angle actually did have some good build-up. But, again, you know, the match doesn't happen. That one just kind of sucks. It's not really anybody's fault. But, you know, the interpromotional tag match, Tigre, Uno, and Manic, no build-up to these matches. So are people really supposed to buy a pay-per-view for matches that they don't even, you know, understand are going to be part of this? And then the underwhelming main event matches just make this feel like a mediocre show for me. I just thought it was okay, an okay pay-per-view overall. Let me know what you guys thought of TNA's lockdown down below in the comment section. I'm not hating on TNA. This is a word to the wise here. I'm not hating on TNA and saying they suck. And I'm not saying that this pay-per-view sucked. I thought it was okay. I didn't think it was that terrible. There were some things that I enjoyed, but some things that I didn't enjoy. And the biggest moments and the most important pieces to this pay-per-view lacked, in my opinion. Even with that said, I thought it was an alright show. Just okay. If I was to recommend for those that don't, that haven't watched yet, I'm not going to tell you not to watch it, but I'll say there's only a few things to watch for. But anyway, that's it. Let me know what you thought of Lockdown down below. Be sure to like a little bit of an underwhelming pay-per-view for me. Like this video, be sure to comment your thoughts and subscribe for plenty more to come. And like I said, not the worst. TNA is, you know, I think the TNA has a lot of upswing to come from here. I think their product has been getting better consistently over the weeks, and I hope that it's going to continue to. I think it can, and I don't think Lockdown was a failure. I just think it was just an all right pay-per-view. Didn't blow me away in any way, shape, or form. And I think that, you know, it just was all right. I thought the order structure of the match card was fine and everything, but I just think that the biggest matches had the worst finishes, and a couple of the matches didn't even really have a whole lot to them anyway, and none of them really were better than decent. So with that said, it just turns out to be an okay pay-per-view. So let me know what you guys thought, just to kind of explain it. Like I said, down below, follow me on Twitter, EMUltraOfficial. Handle in the description, as well as add me to your circles on Google Plus. Outside of that, that's it for Lockdown. Raw review tomorrow for those that care. I mean, a lot of people may watch my TNA videos and not watch my WWE ones, but I will be doing a Raw review tomorrow night. And until then, that's it. So thanks for watching, and until next time, peace out.